Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Carl Frederick. I'm president of the American Pro Se Association, and this is our 11th show. We're here to entertain you a little bit, but primarily to help you with information that you can use, business, finance, and legal. As you know, American Pro Se Association is a not-for-profit organization, and we are all unpaid volunteers. And again, one of the callers tonight will be drawn at random later in the week to get a free copy of this nice little law book. And everybody that calls in, leaves their name and address, will get a copy of the newsletter, a whole year's subscription free. The subscription of Proceeding Pro Se, which will help you with a lot of legal, financial, and business problems. Now, tonight, the primary subject is divorce. Although the gentleman we have is also practicing and knowledgeable and landlord-tenant. But first, we're going to go through our usual routine, which is on my left, your right. We have Fred Scapato, who's a regular on the program.
Hi, Carl.
Hi, Fred. And Fred, of course, as you know, does torts and labor law. And on my right is our guest this week, Mike Panagas. Hi, Mike. And Fred, if you would just explain to the audience a little bit of what we can and can't do on this program for them in terms of legal.
You bet. This show is not to be relied on. You're not to rely on it for legal advice. We recommend that in case you need an attorney, to go seek an attorney. What the show can do is it can provide you with a direction. It can provide you with legal information. But it does not replace an attorney.
Fred, we also should point out to the audience that they can call at any time on any subject, although, you know, we do have a divorce and landlord-tenant expert here, but you're free to call at any time on any subject. And Mike, speaking of divorce, tell us a little bit. For instance, what about the college tuitions and making the father pay for tuition? Yeah,
that's an interesting subject, and it's a timely one because it's September. School is starting. People are back in college. And it's an issue that can become very difficult for the litigants, for people involved in going through a divorce, or even years after they've been divorced. These are the type of issues that show up many years later. They could have been divorced 12 years ago, and now all of a sudden the children are going to college, and that issue arises. In the state of New Jersey, the law is that the non-custodial parent can be compelled to pay for college expenses. There is some, there's a lot of controversy over that, the way it's administered. And as a matter of fact, there's a bill around now. I don't know if it's going to go through, but the bill is the subject of discussion that would eliminate the court's ability to compel parents to pay for college in a divorce circumstance.
Right now, does that extend to graduate school or medical school or law school?
Yes, it can. We're talking about the possibility of many years, and that's the law in New Jersey right now.
Do judges make the students take out loans, or is it expected that the father or the parent who doesn't have control is to pay for it totally?
That's an issue that comes up quite frequently because generally the non-custodial parent, which generally would be the father, may take the position that had we stayed together, had we still been married, we would have been taking out loans. We would have been financing as much of this college education as we could have. And then they find that they have to go to court and try to convince the court that a loan should be taken out, as opposed to perhaps him being compelled to pay the entire cost of the college education. And quite often they find out that the court will not compel the children to take out loans. They will compel the non-custodial parent to pay all or a large portion of the college education, college expenses.
And you're saying that the bill pending before, the proposed bill pending before the legislature would eliminate compelling, or would it just limit that it couldn't be excessively expensive?
No, it would be. Well, there are a lot of bills and a lot of legislation concerning matrimonial law under consideration right now. A lot of it's very controversial. The one issue we've already discussed is a very controversial aspect of it. Mm-hmm. That would eliminate the judge's right or power to compel a parent to pay for college.
Mm-hmm. Besides paying for college, what else does a parent have to pay if once there's a divorce?
Well, you know, that varies from case to case, but of course you have child support is almost an absolute.
And what percentage of someone's salary would that entail? Or is it done that way?
There is what they have now is a set of guidelines. They're charts in which the comparative incomes of the spouses, the father and the mother, are compared. And with some leeway in the charts, depending on the number of children, certain circumstances, you can use these charts to determine what the child support is going to be. The charts have eliminated a lot of difficult issues of determining what adequate child support would be. However, the charts only go up to combined income of $52,000. If the combined income is in excess of $52,000, then there's a lot of other factors that would come into play in determining what the child support would be.
Besides child support, what else does a non-custodial parent have to pay?
Well, of course, you always have the issue of alimony, and the concept of alimony is still alive and well, although some people think it may not be. It's still around. However, it's certainly been watered down, and it's not as prevalent as it used to be. And, of course, that has a lot to do with the fact that there's many more women in the workforce, and they have their own skills. And as a result, a lot of cases, their alimony is not indicated or warranted.
Okay. We're going to go to an Al. How you doing, Al? Hello?
Hi, Al.
Hello? Technical difficulties. Anyway, wait to the next caller.
What about alimony? When does that end? Does that end when the wife is making as much money, or does it only end in New Jersey if the wife gets remarried? How is that determined?
Well, of course, one of the concepts is if there is a remarriage, then the alimony stops. There's other concepts also. There could be an agreement that the alimony only goes for a certain period of time.
Isn't that the trend now, Mike? Just rehabilitative or get started alimony as opposed to permanent alimony?
There are a lot of nuances on the issue of rehabilitative alimony. That generally refers to a circumstance where the wife or the one parent needs some training and go to college. Maybe they've only taken 2 years of college, and by taking 2 more years of college, they will have a marketable skill where they can get into the workforce. And the concept of rehabilitative alimony would be the other spouse would pay alimony during that period of time and pay for the cost, perhaps, of the education. And that would allow the non-working spouse to get into the workforce and support himself or
herself. Who makes the decision as to what type of alimony the spouses have to choose? Can they agree for that particular type, or does the judge generally do whatever he or she wants to do?
Generally, you know, the parties are free to enter into just about any kind of arrangement they want to. And as long as it has some reasonable relationship and is fair, reasonably fair, it will be enforced by the court. There are a lot of nuances to that, though, and there's always the ability to come back to court under changed circumstances.